Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful opportunity you've given me to share the message you put in my heart. I pray, Lord, that you would give me you would help me to communicate a message that will encourage people and point people to Jesus and to help them along their life journey. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. It's so wonderful to see everybody here. I want to begin with a big thank you to all of the people on leadership here, to Pastor Al, to Paul Creech, to Christine, and to everyone who extended Carol, to everyone who extended me the opportunity to be able to speak. So I truly appreciate it. It is an honor to be able to do anything in the house of God. If somebody asks you to clean the bathroom in the church, it's an honor. Is it too loud? Good?
No.
Is it good? Okay.
Perfect.
All right. Good. All right, so it's truly an honor to be here. Now, initially I had a different sermon planned. It was very intellectual, and I started telling some of you about it, about the Greek and the Hebrew and the Old Testament and the New Testament and all of these pieces. But as I was praying about that, I felt like that's not the message that we needed to hear today. And I said, Lord, what is it that you want to tell people? What message do you want to get people? And what I felt the Lord put on my heart was, keep going. That's the message, keep going. And although there are quite a few people out today, one of the things that I can honestly say is I know every single person here, and I know that God has put a desire in the heart of every single person here. And I want to talk to you a little bit about that. Okay. Great, so here's the outline. Today we're going to talk about the promises of God, why I feel like giving up, and why I should keep going. All right, so I want to talk about the promises of God. And like I said, I know that everybody here has a desire in their heart that something God wants you to do. God told us that from the creation of the world, he ordained good deeds for us to walk in so that he should be glorified. So there's something in your heart that God has put there. And it could be something practical, like there are things we all want. We all want to be healthy. We all want to have our finances taken care of. We all want to have healthy relationships and have those. So it could be something very practical like that. Maybe you're looking for a new job, or you're looking to transform your body and to improve your fitness. So there are different practical desires like that. But then I know some of you here have strong spiritual desires, and I've talked to many of you about that. And I know Carol and Paula have such a heart for revival, and they just want to see God's Spirit pouring out on people. And Pastor always talks about the importance of authenticity. And every time he comes up, he says, I don't want to just speak just to say something. I want to say a message that's true and that impacts people. And I know Annie, I think I saw Annie earlier today. Annie always tells me about how she's praying for the salvation of her friends and family members who have gone astray. And Pastor here, believing for healing from his cancer.
Yes.
And these promises could come to us in many different ways. So you could have a promise from the scriptures. And I know Annie, every time, there's Annie, hi Annie. Every time I see Annie, we talk and she tells me, the Bible says, train up the child in a way, the way they shall go, and when they're older, they'll not depart from it. So I know my children are going to come back, our relationship Amen. Will be restored, we're coming to Christ. She's standing on the word of God. Or Pastor, we talk, and he's believing the scriptures for the healing, that Jesus said, by my stripes you are healed, and he's believing it. So it could be a promise you have from the scriptures. Or it could be God sent you someone to give you a message and said, I had a dream, or I had a vision, or I had something about you, and I saw that God's desire is for you to have success in this area, or to grow. Or it might just be a desire in your heart that there's some desire you've had there and you've had for years, and you say, Lord, there's this thing that I'm really desiring and I want, and you know that it's from God. You know that it's from God. But despite all of these promises and desires we have, there are reasons that we feel like giving up.
Come on.
Right. Now, here's an outline of some of the reasons we're going to talk about. So you've got this desire, you're all excited, God said, I'm going to do this, I'm going to have that, my children will be saved, I'll be healed, something amazing is going to happen. But then these things happen. People don't understand me. The devil is opposing me. It's taking too long. Nothing is happening, and I'm tired. The first thing I wanted to talk about is people don't understand me. I don't know if this has happened to you, but God puts something in your heart, and you're excited, you read it in the Word, or you have a dream, or something, and you're so excited, and then you tell someone else, like, why would you do that? Why does that matter? We already have something kind of like that. I don't know. It's not that exciting. So people don't understand you, and you're like, what do you mean? You almost can't comprehend it. You're so excited, and you're so on fire, and then somebody else, right? Well, there's some verses that the Scripture talks about this. I have some verses from the Gospel of John here. It says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not understood it. Now, of course, this is specifically talking about Jesus in this verse, but it can also be applied to Christ in us, that those promises we talked about. Now, at one point, Jesus went through the same thing. He was the Son of God, but people around him said, you're that carpenter, you're Joseph's boy, I know you, you ain't nothing, right? And he said, you don't understand now what I am doing, but someday you will. And he wasn't even saying this to those outsiders, he was talking to this to his closest followers, the people who were supposed to be with him and understand him didn't understand him. And as a side note, you can almost hear Jesus groan. It doesn't say it in the text, but you see all of the disciples fighting amongst themselves. Jesus is like, ugh. Okay. And then Jesus says, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds and many more like it. What does this mean? It means, of course, the people around you don't understand you, because God has put a song in you, and he's put something special in you to bring about a change. If everybody else already understood it, there would be no need for you to make that effort to make that change. And in Revelation chapter 3, Jesus is speaking to some of the churches who are suffering persecution, and there are people around them who are supposed to be believers. They're supposed to be men and women of God, but they are persecuting them. And so this is what Jesus says to them. He says, I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. And I think this is such a beautiful picture. Can you imagine a king or a prince? They've got this crown on their head, this glory, and they're walking around, and then somebody comes and steals it off their head. Have you ever felt like that? Have you ever been in a situation where you just felt dishonored? You felt like you shared your heart with somebody and they robbed you of your joy, or they robbed you of your peace. And I recommend you go back into the text and look more into Revelation 3, because there's a lot of information here. It's a very deep text. But the point is that Jesus is saying, don't let anyone steal your crown. See that no one steals your crown. So when you're in that moment and you're sharing with someone, God put this desire in my heart, I'm going to get a new job, I'm going to be reconciled with a loved one, or I'm going to be healed, or I'm going to grow in some way, and they say, that doesn't matter, that could never happen, it's impossible. You can say, what is impossible with man is possible with God. And you can say, I'm not going to let them take my crown. They don't understand me, but I'm going to hold fast to what I'm doing because I have a promise from God. We have examples of this even in our own community here. And I think it's okay for me to share this because Pastor has shared it himself. So Stephanie, who's a member of this church years ago, God put a dream in her heart. She said, we're going to have a food pantry here. And we talked about this even at the beginning. This is a food pantry at this church that feeds thousands of people. I don't know what's the exact number weekly. Thousands of people weekly. And she said, I know God wants me to start this ministry to feed the people in this community. And she brought it up to people in this church, and they said, we don't know if we have the space for it. I don't know if we have the staff for it. I don't know if we have the time for it. And the funny story is about how she ended up getting it going. So she got it going, and now it serves thousands of people. And it's one of the main ministries of this church.
Right.
However, I got to sidetrack for a moment. So this is the story of how this happened. So she brought it up to Pastor and to other people in leadership staff and said, Pastor, God says we need to have a food pantry here. It's going to be amazing. It's going to be thousands of people. And like I said, they said, we don't have the resources. We're not doing it. Forget about it. And so she said, no, I know I heard from God about this. So at night, she came with the refrigerator and snuck it into the basement to start it. And then they started off with that, and they started getting success with that. And then after that, she said, we need to expand. We need not just one refrigerator. We need more room. And again, nothing, but she persisted and got her way. So don't give up. Keep going. Keep going. All right. So the point is, and now, that ministry that nobody agreed with is the main one of the main ministries of this church. Amen. So people don't understand me yet, but they will. Look to someone next to you. People don't understand me yet, but they will. Amen. Let's keep going. Let's keep going. The devil is opposing me. Of course he is. Of course he is. So if you are a believer, you've put your faith in Jesus, you're a child of God, you're doing something to try and improve the world, of course the devil is opposing you. Now, let me give you some examples. So here are, the whole Bible, honestly, is an example, but here are three texts I wanted to point out. In Exodus chapter 1, Pharaoh orders the death of the Jewish boys. That's at the time of Moses, because he knows that Moses is about to be born. Moses is prophesied to be the deliverer of Israel. Same thing at the time of Jesus. Herod hears that there's a Messiah coming who's supposed to be born.
Right.
And he orders the death of all of the Jewish babies. And then lastly, we see the similar pattern in the book of Revelation, where there's a dragon, which symbolically represents the devil, that tries to eat or devour a baby, which is supposed to represent Jesus. Now, all of these passages have literal interpretations about the historical events that happened, so I'm not trying to counteract any of that. But, could you stay on the that slide for a moment? Thank you, Heath. But I think that what this represents symbolically is that when God puts a desire in your heart, the enemy comes to steal it right away when it's weak. Why does the enemy try to attack the babies? Why didn't he wait until Moses was grown and then try to take him out? Because it's easier to take out a child than to take out a full-grown adult. And another text that I think supports this is the parable of the sower. Jesus talks about a farmer went to sow seed, and the seed is the word of God. But as the seed grows, there are different problems that come. The birds come and eat the seed. The weeds choke out the seed. The soil is too hard and the seed can't grow. So what does that mean? It means when you get a word of God, the enemy tries to steal it from you immediately before it can grow, and you have to persevere with that. Could you go to the next slide now, Heath? Thank you. All right, so the devil is opposing me. But, so yes, if you are a believer and you're trying to make a difference in this world, I guarantee you the devil is trying to oppose you. But, if you are a believer, you've got some promises of Scripture that you can stand on when the enemy comes in. I didn't even put that here, but it says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord will raise up a standard against him. The Scripture says, the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. It says, I have given you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you.
Hallelujah.
Another verse that we often quote the first part, but we forget the second part. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all that we ask or imagine. That's the part we usually hear, right? That's the part everyone preaches. He can do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine. Hallelujah, right? Hallelujah, praise God. But here's the next part. According to his power that is at work within us. He can do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine. According to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. So, you do get the hallelujah part at the end, but you have to do something. Have you ever met somebody who said, I'm trying to think of a good example. I should have prepared my examples before. Have you ever met somebody who said, God told me he wants me to to prosper, and I'm going to grow, and I'll be able to give to the church and to people and charities and all these things. You say, wow, that's wonderful. And what are you doing in order to, are you getting your resume ready, or you're taking some classes maybe to get a new job? Nope, just sitting back here enjoying my life. That's how we are, right? Or we say, I want to lose weight, right? I'm trying to cut back, and then cut a few days later, we're getting that Chinese food. I thought you were on a diet. All right, and then the last verse, Christ in you, the hope of glory. And so the thing I want to highlight is you have the if you're a believer, you have the power of God living in you and the authority to overcome the evil one. All right, the devil is opposing me, but I have the authority in Christ. And if you are somebody who's never had the chance to accept Jesus, you can do that today so that you could have that authority in Christ. It's taking too long. This comes back to the trying to lose weight example, right? It seems like it takes forever. It seems like you go out to eat one time, one meal, you go out and you're like, geez, I gained like 5 pounds. But then you try losing weight and you're like, it's been a month and I only lost 2 pounds. But that can be a really real pain when you're trying to get something done and you're suffering because it's taking too long. And the scripture says, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. And this verse encouraged me, especially for years. Many of you know, I would go up to everyone and say, I'm praying to meet somebody. I've been trying to do everything I can. I'm on the dating sites. They're terrible. I'm going to different churches. I'm trying to get myself out there. And nothing happened. And it was just so discouraging to me every time. I'd ask somebody and they'd say, actually, I'm already taken or whatever it might be. So I was so discouraged. And it's painful when you have that desire and you don't see it happening. But now I've got this beautiful woman of God in my life. She is, give her a round of applause.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
She's, I love you, honey. She's better than all of them combined. Yeah. So, yes, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. Next verse. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Why does the Bible say that? Because we want to give up. That's why. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. What is this talking about? This is talking about when you've got that promise in your heart, instead of focusing on, it's taking too long, I don't see anything happening, you say, no, I know this is something God has for me. So I'm going to rejoice even now, even though I don't have what I'm waiting for yet, I'm going to have it. So I'm going to have joy now, I'm going to have peace now, and I'm going to keep moving. As a side note, something that helps practically, if you're feeling really weighed down by a desire you have and it's not happening, just try to forget about it for a little bit. Try to get out of the house, go do something, you know, get something to eat, take a walk, do something, and get your mind off it. The last verse on the side is, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. So it's not just about the promise. It's about the work that God is doing in you. Maybe you're going through this difficulty because it's developing your character. I'm going to say that one more time because I think that's important. Is maybe you're going through this because it's developing your character. And there's a quote from Bishop T.D. Jakes. He says, God's not preparing the blessing for you. He's preparing you for the blessing. God could snap his fingers and you could have everything, right? But you need to have the character to be able to steward that. And this isn't from me. I've heard many preachers use this. I don't know who gave the example. But when you have a young child, if somebody turns 16, They first get their permit, and they said, Dad, I want that car. Give me the keys to the car. I'm going to go. The dad doesn't get him a sports car, right? He doesn't go out and get the Lamborghini, the Maserati. Here, son, I know you wanted this car. Here you are. No. He gets him the old, beat-up clunker that it's fallen apart and, you know, and has, has him practice with that. Has him practice with that until he develops the character and the responsibility in order to steward that. It's taking a long time, but it will be worth it. I promise you, it's taking a long time, but it will be worth it. And I look back now, my mom knows there were so many days I felt so lonely, waiting to meet somebody and trying, and nothing ever happened. And I'd say, I met somebody, and her mom would say, tell me about her. And then I'd tell her, and she's like, meh. But so many days, I was longing to meet somebody, and I just felt so empty. So at the time, it was painful. But now I've got this beautiful woman, and I hold her, and it's so worth it. It's so worth it. So if you have a promise of God, hold on to it. It will be worth it. God is good. Amen. Next thing, why else might you want to give up? Nothing is happening. You're trying to work and it's just, nothing is happening. You look, you know, I've been working on this for a long time and I don't see anything happening. What's going on? Jesus spoke in parables and Jesus asked, what is the kingdom of God like? What shall I compare it to? It is like a mustard seed, which a man took and planted in his garden. It grew and became a tree, and the birds perched in its branches. When you plant a seed, it doesn't grow overnight. It doesn't matter. You can even have the right seed, but it takes time for it to grow slowly. And he gave another parable. What shall I compare the kingdom of God to? It is like a yeast that a woman took and mixed into about 60 pounds of flour, until it worked all through the dough. How many of you like to cook? Raise your hand. I know you do. Okay. How much is 60 pounds of flour? They must be getting for a really big party. That's what I see. But I'm sorry for all the side trails. I just have so many stories. That reminds me of my family, my parents getting ready for Thanksgiving dinner. Everybody else gets to rest and stay in bed, and my parents are off in the kitchen. You hear the pans moving around, and my dad's like, ah, I burned this, and she was getting ready. I think the scripture doesn't say, but I think the point of the parable, she was getting ready for a really big party, a really big joyful event, and waiting for the yeast to work through the dough. Have you ever seen yeast work through dough? Is it like this? Very slowly. So things are happening. I want to tell you that. For your promises, things are happening. It may be slowly, but keep going.
Amen.
All right, Heath. So I'm growing a little bit at a time. I'm tired. Have you ever been tired? I know Louisa, I've just started working some nights again, and Louisa knows I come home, she says, how was your day, my love? And I say, I'm tired. She's like, oh. You ever just been tired? Well, the scripture says that's okay. There are people who have been tired as well. 1 Kings 19, Elijah eats and rests. And in Mark, Jesus just told his disciples that they needed to go and rest. So if you're feeling tired and weary on this journey that you're going through, you can rest. Yes, Heath, you can put that up. I'm tired, but I can rest. Please. All right, so just a recap of what we've talked about so far, which is this. People don't understand me yet. That's a key word, yet.
Yes.
That's a good point, too, if you're struggling with something and you just say, I can't do this yet. Right? People don't understand me yet, but they will. The devil is opposing me, but I have the authority in Christ.
Come on.
It's taking a long time, but it will be worth it. I'm growing a little bit at a time, and I'm tired, but I can rest. Now, there's not a slide for the next piece, but I just wanted to share something for a moment. There's something else I wanted to talk about, but unfortunately I didn't get the chance to make the slides, which is this. So we talked about why you would want to give up and how you can keep going. But I wanted to talk about this as well. What does the Bible say about why you should keep going? What's the reason? Now, I think the first example is you want to keep going just so you can get the benefit. If you're trying to get a new job, you're completing resumes and you're getting training and things so you can get the job. You're trying to lose weight, you're cutting calories, and you're exercising so you can lose weight. So, I mean, part of it is just obvious. You keep going so that you can get the thing you want. But there's more to it than that as well, which is this, that the Bible says that God ordained good deeds for us in advance, that we should walk in them, that people may see our good deeds and glorify the Father in heaven. So by you not giving up on your dream, by you persevering, people around you see that, and that's a testimony to God. And they say, wow, that never happens, but that happened for that person. And I'm going to brag here about one of my brothers. My brother, Brandon, he started off as a janitor. He was a janitor at Big Y, and he had cleaning. That's what he did. But he wanted to get into computers. And so he somehow got the phone number of somebody. You can correct me if I'm wrong with the story. He somehow got somebody's store phone number and began to bug him every day. And he said, do you have a computer job for me? You got a computer? No, we don't have anything. Do you have a computer job for me? No, we don't have anything. Until finally he wore this poor man out. And he said, fine, I got something for you. It's third shift. It's not that great, but if you want to do it, come on down and do it. So that's how he got his start with computers. And now he's the chief technical officer of a company. And that's an admirable thing. And how many of us, if he came to us in that moment and said, yeah, I'm calling this guy, I'm trying to get a computer job, we might say, oh yeah, keep it up. But inside, we're like, we think it, we don't. So keep going. It's a testimony to those around you. Or again, with Luisa, it's an example. My parents have been married for 40 years. 44 years. They've been married for 44 years. That's a testimony. They went through difficulties, and they've told us, I think it's fine for me to share this, right? They went through difficulties, especially at the beginning of their marriage, and they said, that's it. We're done. We're going to give up. But they kept going, and we're busy, as you can see. And now their children are following the Lord, and they are in such an example to their community of when it got tough, they didn't give up. So you should keep going, not only so you can have the benefit, but also so that people can be drawn to Christ and get the glory of God. The other reason you should keep going is because it develops your character. While you're focused on getting something, God is focused on working something in you to getting you to the point where you can be mature enough to handle something. And just because you desire something that's good or spiritual doesn't mean that you're ready for it. And I know we're praying for this church to grow, and in some ways it is, and that's great. But we also have to grow and develop our character so that we can all steward that. So just because you're desiring something good doesn't mean you get it right away. And then the last thing I wanted to talk about is you should do it because Judgment Day. There is a day coming of judgment where Jesus Christ is going to come back, and he's going to be revealed in all of his glory, and your deeds are going to be seen by him, and he's going to open up the books. In Revelation, it talks about Jesus comes, and all of the books are opened, and everyone is brought before God, and there it says the books are opened, so multiple, and it says it compares the book of life. It doesn't say this. This is me reading into it, but I think this is what it means. It compares the book of life, which is what you were destined to do and called to do, with what you really did. And so on that day, God is going to hold you accountable for what you did. And he talks about this in the parables. There's a parable about three servants, and the master goes away for a long time. And that master is symbolically Jesus. And the master gives one servant $10,000. The next servant, he gives $5,000. And the last servant, he gives $1,000. And the master comes back after the long trip. And he says to the first servant, What did you do with my money? I invested it, Master. I earned $10,000 more. Here, see, here's your $20,000, the $10,000 you gave me, and $10,000 more I earned. And he says, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's happiness. Then the master goes to the second servant who had the 5,000 talents. And he says to him, what did you do with my money? And he said, I invested it, and I worked hard, and I have 5,000 more. And the master doesn't berate him and say, well, the other guy got made $10,000. Why didn't you do that? He evaluates him based off his ability. And he said, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into your master's happiness. And then he comes to the third servant, and he said, what did you do with my $1,000? And you think that he's going to say, I earned another $1,000, right? Good. And then the master would have been happy with him. Because it's not how much or how little you have, it's what you do with it. But he asked the one with the $1,000, he said, what did you do with my $1,000? He said, well, I know that you're a greedy man and that you try to benefit off of the hard work of others. Right. So what I did was I took your $1,000 and I buried it in the ground. And now that you're back, here's the $1,000 that you gave me. And then the master looks at him and he says, you wicked and evil servant, depart from me. Get away from me. I never knew you because you were not faithful with what I gave you. And so why should you keep going? There's practical reasons, but there will be eternal reasons as well on the judgment day. And the scripture talks about crowns. Paul, I don't see Paul Creech here, but Paul did a beautiful study about the crowns mentioned in the Bible, the crown of righteousness, the crown of life, the eternal crown. The scriptures say, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And now there is in store for me a crown of life, but not only for me, also for all those who longed for his presence. So it may be that you're longing for God's presence. It might be in a simple way. You're longing for a restored relationship. You're longing for that healing. You're longing for that growth in your life. It could be something practical. Or maybe it's something spiritual. You're longing for that revival in the church. You're longing for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You're longing for a new desire for the Word of God. You're longing for spiritual things. Yes. Keep going. Or you could be longing for the ultimate prize, which is on that day of judgment, you stand before God, and he presents you that crown of life, and he says, well done, good and faithful servant. And I know every one of us here want to be that servant. We don't want to be the one who he said, depart from me, you wicked servant, I never knew you. We want to be that one who he says, well done. So let's bow our heads, and I'm going to pray one more time to close us. Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, we thank you. I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity I had to speak. And I pray, Lord, that despite my failures and flaws, you were able to speak through me and touch the hearts of these people today. I pray, Lord, that if there's someone here who's never made that decision to follow Jesus, that you would put it in their heart to quietly make that decision now. For those who have decided to follow Jesus, Lord, I pray that you would help them to keep going, to achieve all that you have for them, so that on that day, they would hear the words, well done, good and faithful servant. And Lord, I pray that this message would bless all who heard it. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen. Thank you all.